God is a creator. That's why nobody can keep him in a corner. If you don't find him in a test tube, you can find him in the supernatural tube. You see him somewhere. That's why most of the things that people say, we don't understand why. We don't understand because we are tuned to one way of doing things. And so when God wants to do something for you, and you say that, okay, maybe I need some repairs. Whatever God cannot repair, he replaces.
Precious viewers, it's a great opportunity to come to your house this early morning. I want to welcome you to our program, The Supernatural and the Glory, from the Holy Hill Chapel Assemblies of God. The scripture tells us that the sign that Jesus is in a place is miracles, signs, and wonders. Acts chapter 2, verse 22, and I want to read something to you this morning. It said, "Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus Christ, a man approved of God amongst you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves know." The supernatural and the glory is bringing the power of God to your houses. As you watch out this morning, any mountain, any challenge, any problem, the supernatural power of God is going to reach you, and your life will never be the same. We have seen God move in amazing ways. The dead raised, the sick healed, miracle money, all kinds of things, because Jesus is in our midst. This morning, as we take you to the auditorium and as we listen to God's word, the Bible says, "Faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word." My name is Kojo Boateng Bempa. Let's get back to the auditorium. And I know the power of God is going to hit you right there, and your life will never be the same. Expect a miracle. I'll be back to pray for you. Share winning the war against sexual immorality, which is also one major battle that the church is fighting. Individuals are fighting it, and many people have fallen down through some of those bullets. The trap of moral impurity is one of the battles, because you have to understand that these things are from hell. They rise up against the church from hell. Your title notwithstanding, you have to fight this battle as an individual. That's as some part, some you hear somebody say, they say he's a pastor. They say he's a, you see, those things don't mean anything. You have to fight this battle as an individual. Why? Our God is a holy God, and he demands that his children walk in holiness. We can only walk with him if we walk in holiness. The devil knows that. In holiness, we will see and enjoy all the wonderful blessings of God. Therefore, the devil's number one target is against your closer walk with God. He doesn't care about your shoe and all those kind of things that people pray about. It's against your closer walk with God. The devil doesn't care if you are blessed, you have wives, you have children, you have cars. As far as you don't like going to church, it's all right with you. And you don't like praying, and you don't like spiritual things, it's all right with you. Why? He has plans to desecrate us, so that we can grieve the heart of God. and to miss our heavenly glory. The greatest desire of every child of God is that one day you will see God face to face in eternity. At that moment, all your pain, you will forget about them. In one of the revelations, one Russian man went to heaven and he was receiving to the apartment of Prophet Jonah. He asked Jonah, like many of you have questions. He said, I want you to know, heaven is not far from us. He asked Jonah, Charlie, how did you feel when you were in the belly of the fish? Oh, Jonah gave him all the answers. And Jonah said to him that, thank God I obeyed God. If I did not obey God, none of the Ninevites will be in heaven today. But today there are a lot of Ninevites in heaven. He said, don't be thinking that they are very far away from us. They are very, very, very close. And as the days go by, I'm going to share so many revelations. And another revelation about Moses, when Moses and Elijah came to, what I'm saying is not in the Bible, but it's true. When Moses and Elijah, you remember on the mountain of transfiguration, the two of them came. So Moses said that journey that he took on earth. You know, many of you say that Moses saw the promised land, but he didn't step there. But by that encounter on the mountain of transfiguration, that his vision was fulfilled, because that mountain was Mountain Horeb, where they met Jesus. And according to when they were passing by, they came with Michael. Michael told them, Michael showed Moses a place and he said, this is where your dead body was buried. Moses, Charlie, can you let me have a look? He said, no, let us go when we are coming. So when they were coming, and he asked one of the most important questions. The question that Moses asked was, why did God bury my dead body? He said that the devil wanted us to bring your dead body for a public burial. And if we have done that, Israel will have worshipped your dead body. So it was for a reason. So none of us knows where it has been buried, but they have shown Moses. Because it was a journey. They came from heaven to the earth in a chariot. So I will be sharing some very serious. Is it true or is it not true? It's true. Yeah, you show him. He said, this is where you were buried. And then he was also asking questions. There are so many things we need to know. You see, when you begin to know some of these things, you see the way you serve God so happily, very powerfully. How I wish I can break your head and pour all those kind of revelations inside. So it's exciting. I'm so happy because it's like I'm in heaven already, hearing all these powerful revelations. Glory to Jesus. Amen. Somebody lift your hand and say, I will be there by always. So our greatest desire is to see God face to face in eternity, but we cannot go until our garments are white. When you go to heaven, there are people, they've done bad things, and then one day they did something good, and that was when they died. When you appear in heaven like that, you have cloth, but your cloth is very light. And so those then, when they see you, they will know that this guy, he just escaped. That is why you got to be serious working for God, because what you even wear even shows how you came. But I see you going fully loaded. Ecclesiastes 9:8. Let thy garment be always white, and let thy head lack no ointment. Always white, not sometimes. So you have to fight to make sure that you walk in purity always, every day, because you may never know. Now, one of the things that is going to happen in this end time is that we may not actually see people dying, but angels will come for people. Like you are in your room and two angels will come and they will say that, let us go. You see, you don't know how I'm going to explain it to you. Now, what is going to happen, that if people are around you, they will see you going down like in coma, but actually, the angels are there and they are saying, let us go. Yes. One man, they came to him like that, and he told his servants, he said, please, don't take my body to the mortuary, because they say we'll be back. They say we'll be back. There's going to be so many heavenly experiences. So get ready for a flight. Tell your friend, get ready for what? A flight. I'm not joking at all. Serious. So let thy garment always be. I don't know what you are looking for on it here. There's nothing here. The glories are stacked up there. Let thy garment be always white. Scripture says that we should let our garment be white. It means purity. Be pure. Why? The church in the wilderness suffered from this trap of immorality. Sexual sin brought calamity on that church. And we saw 23,000 people die in a day. That's the greatest number of God's people that have ever lost their life. 1 Corinthians 10, 6 to 8. The devil, he doesn't change his strategies. He repeats them. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6 to 8. Now, these things were our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things. As they lusted, so a believer can be lusting after evil things. Neither be ye idolaters, as were some of them, as it is written. The people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Now, the word rose up to play, that they rose up to fornicate. That's what it means. They were sleeping among themselves in the wilderness whilst Moses was waiting upon the Lord. So he said, neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed and fell in one day 23,000. 23,000 people died. Why? Because they committed immorality. Today, immorality remains the devil's greatest weapon against God's people. May you not fall into that trap of destruction. We have already said sin is deceptive, pleasurable, but in the end, it brings shame, regret, and death. So let us therefore flee from the trap of sexual sins. We are admonished not even to discuss sex things amongst us. Ephesians 5, 3. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3. Why am I preaching all these messages? Because I believe that Jesus is coming soon. Even if he doesn't come, death can come and carry you. Because there are two types of second comings. Coming, the general one, and you can also do your own coming. So the day you fall dead, you have come. And don't be thinking that it's only old people who die. I also learned this week that all the children that have died, they've gone to heaven. And actually, when somebody dies and is young, they grow in heaven. They can grow up to 30 years. Yeah. So if your child dies, don't cry. You grow. There are so many things we don't know. That's why our lives are some way. When we know them, you will see that you'll be the happiest person moving in life. Because, Charlie, you have gained everything on. By giving your life to Christ, you have gained everything. Ephesians 5:3, tell your friend, let thy garment always be white. Yeah. Always. Because I don't know when the heavenly child will arrive with your name as the next invitee. And those chariots, they run at supersonic speed. Ephesians 5:3, it says, I'm preaching something, but something is busting me. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be one's name among you as become a saint. So when you become born again, there are things that should not become even part of your discussions. Like chasing girls in church, or chasing men in church, or you are in the church but your life is some way. Bible says we should not even discuss it. As you don't even know where you are. So today in the churches around the world, sexual immorality is affecting the body of Christ because many do not know its spiritual and physical implications. What is sexual immorality that the Bible says we should move away from? He has confused many people. Some of them are even married. Oh, my wife is not romantic. My husband is not romantic. Because of that, you see, the devil is confusing you. Sexual immorality is any form of sexual relationship outside the context of marriage between one man and one woman. Because if I don't say between one man and one woman, some people say after marriage it can be 3-3-3, 2-2 against four. Any kind of sexual, because so in the context of God, you are not supposed to have any kind of sexual relationship if you are not married. That's all. So when you go outside the context of marriage to kiss, to sleep, to be touching, you are in immorality. And that is what killed 23,000 people. Now, what are the areas that fall? Now, you read the scripture, you see that a lot of mighty people that work with God almost miss it. So it's a past question for us. Almost miss it. Some miss it. Some do almost miss it. So the Bible said the thing that have been written has been written for our example. So you don't play around such fires. So there are things that fall under this category that the modern day church must run away from. The first one is fornication. I'm going to define all of them. What is fornication? It always happens among single people. Fornication is illicit relations or relationship with another single person. Sometimes they are not married, they live together. Maybe you are one of such in the church. God wants you to shift. Go and pack your things and leave. Go and sleep on somebody's veranda. Instead of using an example that I don't have a place to sleep. When I came to Accra, there wasn't any place. And the brother wanted to help me. And the sister wanted to help me. You will be there, you go to hell. The second form that is fighting so many destinies is idolatry. Sexual relation with someone other than your wife or husband. Sexual relation with someone other than your wife or husband. Or engaging in sexual relationship with someone who is married to another person. Married to another person. You need to run away from such things. The devil will bring that desire, but you have to tell him that I have caught you, I know you. He will bring that desire into you. You will see people in your offices. Some of them will do you fine, but that fine is fine for nothing. Don't translate it into something else. Number three, I'm showing you the arsenals that they will be throwing against us today. All of us. Number three, under this form of evil that we have to fight, is homosexuality and lesbianism. What is that? Having sexual relationship with someone of the same gender or sex. Homosexuality, a man and a man, a woman and a woman. Today, that devil called Mystery Babylon. Now, I spoke about this evil spirit in Revelation 17 on the Valentine night. Those of you who didn't come, maybe you thought we were just dancing in the place. We were sharing a real message. It's an evil spirit released into the atmosphere. And she is behind this all kinds of sexual perversion. When two men say they want to marry, two women say, of course, it cannot be normal. It is an evil spirit. And so, this is what is plaguing our society today. Man to man, homosexuals. Woman to woman, lesbians. This is against the normal order of life. And the Bible says it is abomination unto God. Leviticus 18:22. So if you see a woman and you are being attracted to that woman, go and slap her so that there will be a fight between the two of you. And then you'll find yourself somewhere. Hey! It has caught many people. Today we have pastors who say they are homosexual. They are not pastors. Leviticus 18:22. Look at it. Say, thou shalt not lie with mankind. That is a man of your kind or a woman of your kind.
or as with womankind, it is abomination. It doesn't matter who is saying it, whether a president of whatever, they are wrong. Today there are organizations that give money to people so that they can become gays. They sponsor you. If you want to marry Jonathan, they will sponsor you. The devil is now paying for people to do abominable things. And Romans chapter 1 says that because they did not retain God in their mentality, he gave them up to dishonor themselves. So if you are a lesbian, you are dishonoring yourself. You are a gay, you are dishonoring yourself. In fact, even animal wisdom is better than your own. But the animals have not gone to that level. But it is an evil spirit that can attack anybody here. Yeah. It can attack you. That's why you need to hear messages concerning it. Before you carry your brother to a pastor in England, and you say that bless us. Next thing that falls under sexual immorality. Because in this thing, even now today, there are churches around the world where they feel that those homosexuals can also come to churches. So it's also another form of lifestyle. You see, the pastors that are saying that, are you the one who wrote the Bible? You came to find it to preach from. Why don't you just say what is inside? You see, it's not like you are trying to show your, you just say what is inside, and like as I've read it, you know. If you feel insulted, go and fight the Bible. I'm reading what has been written for you. You know, the pastor came to church. He said homosexuality is not good. Which was I didn't say it's good or bad. I read Leviticus 18:22. If you have any fight, go and fight Leviticus. It's a simple thing. So yeah, pastor, you are afraid. If I preach it, the gays in my church will get a what nonsense. Do you have a Bible? When we came, he gave us a book to preach it. When you go to court, the lawyers don't bring any other interpretation. They bring the constitution. They say that Article 114 verse 2 says da. Just read it. Read it. Most of these things is the fault of the pastors. Because they will say what they are supposed to say. They will say they are preaching philosophy. They will say, read the Bible, Leviticus 18:22. Thou shalt, please, can you even give it to me in another version? They will say they don't understand mankind or humankind. So that I will read it. No man is to have sexual relation with another man. God hates that. It's clear. So if you're a believer, you have a friend who is like that, read, go and read it to him tomorrow. That it's not that I'm against you, but I'm reading this scripture to you. You understand? Yeah. Because our inability to become bold with the truth has confused so many people. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah.
My daughter is in KG1. Yes. And she was supposed to go to KG2. So I told my husband that I'll let the mantle work. I'll skip her.
Yeah.
So somebody said there was a school around Jolu.
Okay.
So I went there. They said they wouldn't give my daughter admission because they admit based on recommendation. Mm-hmm. So who recommended? I said, don't worry, I don't know here. If it hadn't been for recommendation, I wouldn't have come this far.
Yeah.
So they said, okay, there's no space, but she needs to compete for the only space with an Indian girl.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, okay. The next day, mm-hmm. I sent my daughter. They said they needed to write an exam.
Yes.
Yes, so I sent my daughter.
Yeah.
Before we left the house, I placed the mantle over her head mm-hmm. and prayed for her.
Prayed for her.
Yes. So when we went, I saw the Indian girl. The moment the Indian girl saw my daughter, she started fretting. They went into the exam hall, and then 5 minutes later, the girl came and said she won't write the paper.
The Indian
again.
Girl?
Yes.
Came and said she won't write the exam again?
Yes.
Why?
Then
what happened?
I don't know. Then the mother said, no, go in and write. So she went there, and then she came back again. So I saw them going. I couldn't ask them anything. Mm-hmm. And my daughter was there for like 1 hour.
Mm-hmm.
And when she came back, I asked her what she was doing. She said her teacher was taking her around.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked the madam, what is happening? She said, oh, they're having a conversation. Mm-hmm. When they are done, mm-hmm. they'll talk to me. So she came back and said that They have given my daughter instant admission.
Instant admission?
Yes.
Wow.
They gave her instant admission, mm-hmm. and that she's supposed to pay $5,000 mm-hmm. a term. Mm-hmm. So I looked at the lady and said, are you serious? Said, oh, but however, when they met as a board, mm-hmm. they decided to waive 3,500 offers because of her academic excellence.
Wow.
They have been calling me, but I still haven't gone because I'll try the mantle somewhere else.
Wow. Jesus is doing the same for you this morning.
Glory to Jesus. We have seen it all. What a blessing. What a glory. We have seen the glory and the power of God. Right now, as you are watching us, I want to pray with you. Maybe you don't know Jesus. You have not taken him as your Lord and personal Savior. You can't experience his power and you cannot experience the miracles and the joy that we are experiencing in our church and in Christ Jesus. I want to pray with you in case you are not born again. There is one major decision you want to make in your life. Say this after me wherever you are. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I come to you a sinner. Forgive me my sins. Wash me by your blood. Come into my heart. I know you died and resurrected for me. Jesus, save me because only you can save. Father, I thank you for this opportunity. I declare today, Jesus is Lord over my life. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. If you have prayed this prayer, I want you to know that you are now born again. I want to pray for miracles into your house. Father, in the name of Jesus, anybody watching us, I see a lady watching. Your name is Techiwa. You are around the Kumasi area. And you've been diagnosed with something in your breast. I declare in the name of Jesus, be healed in Jesus' name. There is a woman. You have two daughters. And the father is not home. And you are struggling with paying school fees. I pray for miracle money for you. The Lord is even speaking to me concerning so many people. Wherever you are watching us from, whether you are in the hospital, there is a woman called Grace. You are having crisis in your marriage. I pray that this morning as you watch, the power of God is going to hit your house and your life will never be the same. Father, I pray for everybody that needs a miracle. Receive your healing right now. Receive intellectual miracles. Every area that you need a miracle, I pray for you in the mighty name of Jesus. Those of you under any demonic attack, I declare be free in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for touching our viewers. We are expecting testimonies and great, 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 great things happening to anybody that watch out this one. Join us same time next week on this very station. Your life and destiny will never be the same. See you.
God is a creator. That's why nobody can keep him in a corner. If you don't find him in a test tube, you can find him in the supernatural tube. You see him somewhere. That's why most of the things, God, that people say we don't understand why. We don't understand because we are tuned to one way of doing things. And so when God wants to do something for you, and you say that, okay, maybe I need some repairs. Whatever God cannot repair, he replaces. Okay, I need a replacement. They say there's no replacement. Where there is no replacement, when God comes, he can create. So he's not a limited God. And that unction is upon the Abrahamic family. Now look at Joseph. Joseph went to Egypt. In the then known world, he preserved food for 7 years. We don't know the chemical that the man used. He was just like a prophet who had gone to interpret somebody's dream. And then he said to Pharaoh, if you can find any man who is agriculturally attuned to do this job, Pharaoh said, who should we find? You are the man. And then all of a sudden, the Bible said, Joseph was able to preserve food until the Lord came. And the whole world went to him. And everybody that went to Pharaoh said, go see Joseph. The Bible said, in those days, money lost value. Joseph became the man of the city, the man of the town. In the name of Jesus, wherever men want to keep you, by this anointing of creativity, this year you are coming out of that corner in the name of Jesus.